You're listening to the audio production of Behind Closed Doors, a guide to help parents and teens navigate through life's toughest issues by Jessica L. Peck, DNP, APRN, published by Thomas Nelson and read by the author. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperchristianaudio.com. Disclaimer. The information in this book has been carefully researched by the author and is intended to be a source of information only. Readers are urged to consult with their physicians or other professionals to address specific medical or other issues. The author and the publisher assume no responsibility for any injuries suffered or damages incurred during or as a result of use or application of the information contained herein. Dedication. With great admiration, appreciation, and affection, I dedicate this book to my four children. They embrace our family mantra of, "To whom much is given, much is required." They are an integral, supportive force in this book journey. They make hospital rounds with me on Christmas Eve. They wait in hospitals and clinics for me to finish seeing patients with my pleading, "Five more minutes." Every summer when I was a camp nurse, they brought me lonely or hurting kids saying confidently, "My mom will help you." They wait patiently and quietly through hundreds of hours of phone calls and meetings, at home, in the car, at the ballpark. They are examined by countless students as pretend patients for practice. They let students give them shots. They travel with me, joining me for dinner to share their adventures of the day. They are a practice audience for speeches. They see the recording sign in my office and they tiptoe around like little church mice until given the all clear. They hear more lectures on pediatric health than any kid should ever endure. They sit through painfully boring ceremonies. They edit the stories I write. They educate me on the latest teen trends. They serve as photographers and social media managers. They clap and cheer when I speak at their school or in our community. They accept my talking about embarrassing subjects in public forums and even thank me for having the courage to do it. Because of my work, they know the world is a scary place. But they also know there is hope and light in the world and how to share it. They know God's mercies are new every morning. They are the inspiration behind everything I have done or will ever do. You are loved beyond measure and have filled my heart with greater joy. To my dearest husband, my most faithful companion, most dedicated supporter, most fervent champion, and most cherished friend, thank you for bearing all things, believing all things, hoping all things, and enduring all things. You are a treasure. May our family's journey reflect the love, healing, restoration, and freedom found in the love of God. Introduction. How to unlock the door to a new relationship with your teen. I was in the driver's seat of my car having a recurrent and heated argument with my then 13-year-old daughter who was in the back seat. When it happened, something heavy whooshed past my shoulder, centimeters from my face. To my utter amazement, in anger, she had thrown the book she was reading right at my face while I was driving. My mind raced a million miles an hour in shock as I frantically pulled over. What in the world? Surely my adored and angelic daughter did not just hurl a book at my head. How could more than a decade of painstaking parenting effort with my expertise as a pediatric nurse practitioner arrive at this rude awakening? Days before, she had left a handwritten manifesto on my pillow, outlining my many shortcomings in painstaking detail. I didn't give her enough freedom to choose her clothes or friends. I was strict, mean, and uncaring. I didn't trust her. I embarrassed her. But most of all, I didn't understand the challenges she was facing in, quote, modern times, end quote, as I was raised in, quote, literally the previous century, end quote, she said. My thoughts returned to the present as I tearfully put the car in park. Am I a fraud? A failure? Am I crossing over into the much-discussed, miserable abyss of parenting a teen? Will I pass on generational trauma and lose my carefully cultivated relationship with my daughter, which was my single greatest fear? I pulled over. I took deep breaths, and I did the most important thing by far I had learned to do as a mom. I prayed, tearfully, loudly, and I made a life-altering decision. In that moment, I committed to do everything humanly possible to reverse my family trend and beat the odds. My relationship with my mother became strained in my teen years before completely crumbling in early adult years with no recovery. Although I had advanced professional knowledge of pediatrics, I certainly had no personal role model for parenting a teen, no wisdom to gain from my relationship with my parents, no parental support on which to rely. But God, my favorite phrase in the history of ever. I was raised in a world that revolved around family and church, and I'm grateful for my heritage of faith. I grew up in the era of modesty culture, purity rings and abstinence pledges, youth camp, trust falls, WWJD bracelets, sword drills, kissing, dating goodbye, and edgy modern songs like Our God is an Awesome God. Some of you are having flashbacks. Although conversation about faith was frequent, conversation about personal matters was unthinkable. Whispered conversations with my church friends found me listening wide-eyed as they shared sketchy details of sexual escapades and drinking experiments. Their parents didn't know, or if they did, they never said a word. Without the internet, we relied on peer-to-peer information sharing with gems such as, you can't get pregnant your first time, or jumping jacks after sex prevents infections. I would have rather died than ask my mother about something like the missionary position, which, by the way, was nothing like any missionaries I'd ever heard about in church. So, how did I officially learn about the birds and the bees? One fateful day, at the age of 10, my mother handed me a book on puberty to peruse and left me to figure out the mysteries of reproduction before watching a video at school, where all I remember is a mother making pancakes in the shape of a uterus. The next official conversation I had on the matter occurred in my women's health course in nursing school at the age of 18. I listened to a lecture on sex, scribbling notes furiously in absolute shock. I peeked around carefully as the classroom seemed quiet, and to my utter amazement, people were sleeping. They knew this stuff? I took a late-night stealthy trip to Walmart, where I sneaked down that aisle to see if the products they told me about in class were, in fact, real. They were. Imagine my humiliation as I encountered the word spermicide and an overwhelming variety of condoms in front of God and everybody. I tried to reconcile in my mind this was not some seedy store with neon lights on the freeway, but the place where people bought dental floss and bath towels. I realized in that moment that for the first time I thought sex was bad and I didn't know why. In fact, everything in my life at that time seemed categorized into good and bad. I felt an inescapable pressure in the absence of authentic parental relationships to hold an unattainable standard of a perfect public image. I experienced a crippling yet inexplicable guilt complex. This crushing sense of inadequacy fed a perpetual shame of hypocrisy. It was quietly debilitating, with no path to relationship restoration outside of immediate and unquestioning compliance. I increasingly chased a brutal and unrelenting standard of perfection, trying to be the good girl, as if somehow I could earn the approval of my parents, an elusive pursuit. My legalistic approach to remain above reproach left me perceived as unrelatable, unapproachable, and just plain unlikable. I lost myself, trying to be what my parents wanted me to be, namely submissive and subservient. My deepest desire was to be known and loved and to have a parental relationship filled with acceptance, affection, and understanding. Instead, I encountered rejection, isolation, and disapproval of any hesitation to accept my predetermined life's calling to be a ministry wife and mother immediately after high school graduation. I longed for the freedom to pursue an education. I was bright, but had no accessible university path. And in my wildest dreams, I could only imagine myself, as a woman, being a nurse or a teacher. Conflict over my choice to go to community college for nursing escalated until one day I found myself at my grandmother's house, desperate and silently begging for what I didn't even know. I was then accustomed to living in my parents' garage with few creature comforts and working three jobs to pay for school, rent, transportation, and food, all of which made my granny's extra bedroom, private bath, and encouraging words seem like an oasis. In the morning, she made a lavish breakfast with a formal table setting using real plates and real silverware. I couldn't even bring myself to entertain the hope that I could stay, and I found myself simply grateful for the momentary reprieve. As I solemnly picked up the blue checkered cloth napkin to place in my lap, my eyes began to comprehend the image of a key on the table next to my plate. My face lifted to Granny's with the audacity of a single spark of fragile hope. With no words, she nodded affirmation of her offer to support my purported rebellion with a place to stay and emotional support when I had neither, even as we both knew it would cost her dearly. That key unlocked more than the door to my new home. It opened the door to a new future I couldn't have ever dared to imagine. As I grew in my professional role as a pediatric nurse, I eagerly anticipated being a mother. But my early years as a parent were marked by deep insecurities, desperate to spare my children from the pain of separation and disapproval I had endured. One day, as I sat on a recliner weeping over broken relationships, my husband took a photo of me. I felt so betrayed in that moment of vulnerability, but he lovingly told me, "This was what my young children saw every day. My mournfully watching real life passing by while I wept for the life I'd never have." Something shifted in me and I vowed to be present. That day I came to the crushing revelation that perfection is not attainable. Real love is not earned. And it was no longer my job in life to protect others from the consequences of their own destructive actions. My relationship with my parents has been mostly absent for more than a decade. Being estranged from the people who gave me life created a lonely, deep abyss that often felt insurmountable. The grief that accompanies this type of relationship loss is soul-wrenching. There were so many times I wanted to be able to speak freely, to be held, comforted, reassured, and understood, but the gap has not been mended. It is because of these deep hurts and the still small voice of loneliness that sometimes rages like the sea in my soul that I want to ensure my teenagers will never feel the wretchedness of that kind of aloneness. It is also the reason I want to support and encourage other parents of teens who may also be exploring these tough teen issues alone, but without ever having the opportunity to learn how to have meaningful conversations in a parent-child relationship. That day, in the car with my daughter, I knew there were challenges ahead, but I had no clue of the enormous and unprecedented struggles waiting for us around the bend. I didn't know a thing about social media, vaping, sexting, cyberbullying, social justice, or COVID-19. What I did know is that I would be prepared to help my teens navigate whatever came their way. What started as a book thrown at me became a new story of building healthy relationships with my teens. It wasn't the end of the road for us, but the start of a new and beautiful adventure. We have navigated together some of the toughest challenges facing teens today. Now God has laid it on my heart to share lessons from this journey with you, personal and professional, good and humiliatingly bad, utterly mundane and truly miraculous. Welcome to your personal journey to invest in strengthening your relationship with your teen so you can navigate in a healthy way through life's toughest challenges together. The fact you picked up this book tells me your heart aches for soul-deep conversations with your teen. You want to share their fears, hopes, and dreams. You desperately want to be a good parent, but like me, you fear your failures will scar them for life. When we were growing up, our parents basically just had to keep us alive, right? Be back before dark, they said, and we were. After spending the day looking for coins and riding miles alone on our bikes to buy candy cigarettes at the corner drugstore to gleefully shock our elderly neighbors before coming home and drinking from the hose. And our parents didn't even raise an eyebrow or make us wear seatbelts. Today, parent pressure starts even before birth, with expectations for the perfect Facebook Live gender reveal party, Pinterest-worthy baby shower, and Instagram-worthy delivery. New moms post every milestone on social media and obsess about other babies excelling over theirs. They buy the latest designer baby wear gear and a stroller that closes with the touch of a finger, choose outfits for ridiculously expensive photo shoots, and transform said photo shoots into magazine-worthy holiday cards, interview babysitters like FBI agents, monitor nanny cams, invest in developmentally stimulating toys, buy and prepare organic meals in bento boxes, spend every spare dollar and minute on select sports, work to pay for select sports and a sports utility vehicle to tote the sports equipment, make sure their kids take every advanced placement class, all while meeting every emotional need. If you relate, consider yourself blessed and deeply convicted. Many parents are struggling just to put food on the table and keep a roof over their heads. Media portrayals of teens from all walks of life have a singular commonality as notoriously tumultuous. Movies, television shows, novels, and plays are dedicated to their portrayal. Think Rebel Without a Cause of yesteryear or Dear Evan Hansen of today. Teens in this modern world are facing extraordinary challenges of a different sort than we as their parents ever faced. We need new social skills to parent effectively in a social media, social distancing, and social justice world. Society is changing dramatically at a critical point in teen development that will permanently shape them. Anxiety and depression increase at an alarming rate as public health officials try to balance caution with care in a post-pandemic world. During this time of uncertainty, what teens want more than anything is our time. You might be thinking, I can't get my teen to get their face out of their phone, and I'm the last person on earth they want to spend time with. Research tells us otherwise. The stereotypical notion of spending more time with peers is balanced by the desire to maintain close parental relationships. Parents who invest more time have teens with better social skills. Working to develop better social skills as a parent will help you create inviting conversations and environments for your teens. In a world of instant fixes and instant gratification, there are no instant relationships. Relationship
building. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.